In this video, we will create EKS cluster using Terraform. You can use your existing VPC or create a new one from scratch following this tutorial. When the cluster is provisioned, we will also create OpenID Connect provider using Terraform to be able to assign IAM roles to Kubernetes service accounts. To afterscale EKS cluster based on the load, we will also create IAM role and use it with the afterscaler service account. I'll show you how to deploy a sample app and expose it to the internet using public load balancer. In case you want to keep your application endpoint private, we will create another Kubernetes service of type load balancer and use annotations to make it private. You can find the source code and commands in my GitHub repository. Let's start with Terraform. First, we need to create AWS provider. It allows to interact with many resources supported by AWS, such as VPC, EC2, EKS, and many others. You must configure provider with the proper credentials before using it. I already created AWS configuration file using the AWS configure command. I only need to specify the region where I want to create VPC and EKS cluster. Additionally, you can set version constraints on AWS provider and any others you wish to use in your code. The next step is to create virtual private cloud in AWS using AWS VPC resource. There is one required field that you need to provide, which is the size of your network. 10.0.0.0/16 will give you approximately 65,000 IP addresses. For your convenience, you can also give it a tag, for example, main. To provide internet access for your services, we need to have internet gateway in your VPC. You need to attach it to the VPC that we just created. It will be used as a default route in public subnets. Now we need to create 4 subnets. To meet EKS requirements, we need to have 2 public and 2 private subnets in different availability zones. Let's start with a private subnet in US East 1A zone. Also, we need to provide a cedar block. /19 gives you around 8,000 IP addresses. You can use one of the online cedar calculators to figure out the subnet size. In contrast to the VPC resource where we provided tag for our convenience, some of the tags on the subnets are required by EKS to function properly. The first one is just a name, which will be displayed in AWS console. The following internal ELB tag is required for Kubernetes to discover subnets where private load balancers will be created. We will see it later in action. Also, you need to tag your subnet with a cluster equal to EKS cluster name. In this case, it's a demo. Value can be owned if you only use it for Kubernetes, or shared if you share it with other services or other EKS clusters. The next subnet is also private, but placed in different zone, US East 1B. If you run one of those online cedar calculators, you will find that the last IP in the first subnet is 10.0.31.255. Therefore, we start this subnet with 32.0. The third subnet is public. For this one, we will use 1A zone and map public IP on launch is equal to true, only needed if you want to create public Kubernetes instance groups. Each Kubernetes worker will get a public IP, which is usually not needed. Most of the time, you would use private subnets for instance groups and create public load balancers in public subnets. For load balancers, this attribute is not required. What is required is role ELB equal to 1. This instructs Kubernetes to create public load balancers in these subnets. The last public subnet will only be different in availability zone and cedar range. At this point, even we call these subnets private and public, they technically all private for now since we don't have any routes just yet. It's time to create NAT gateway. It is used in private subnets to allow services to connect to the internet. For NAT, we need to allocate public IP address first. Then we can use it in AWS NAT gateway resource. The important part here, you need to place it in the public subnet. That subnet must have internet gateway as a default route. By now, we have created subnets, internet gateway and NAT gateway. It's time to create routing tables and associate subnets with them. The first is a private routing table with a default route to NAT gateway. Then the public routing table with a default route to the internet gateway. To associate subnets with routing tables, we need to create table association resources for all 4 subnets, starting with private US East 1A, then private US East 1B. Next, public subnets in US East 1A zone and 1B zone. Finally, we got to the EKS cluster. Kubernetes clusters managed by Amazon EKS may cost to other AWS services on your behalf to manage resources that you use with the service. For example, EKS will create afterscaling group for each instance group if you use managed nodes. Before you can create Amazon EKS clusters, you must create IAM role with the Amazon EKS cluster policy. First is IAM role object that we're going to call EKS cluster demo. Then you need to attach the required IAM policy to the EKS cluster demo IAM role. The bare minimum configuration for the EKS cluster itself is to provide the name. In our case, it's a demo. It will be important when we get to afterscaling to use exactly the name of the cluster as a tag. Then the IAM role that we created for EKS. For networking, we need to provide subnets, which EKS can use to create nodes and load balancers. In some resources, we use the depends on key to explicitly depend on other resources. In this case, until the IAM role is ready, EKS cluster won't be created. Next, we're going to create a single instance group for Kubernetes. Similar to the EKS cluster, it requires IAM role as well. In this example, we use built-in JSON encoder Terraform function to convert this object to JSON. When we have a role, we need to attach a few IAM policies. The Amazon EKS node kubelet daemon makes calls to AWS APIs on your behalf. First is Amazon EKS worker node policy. It grants access to EC2 and EKS. Then Amazon EKS CNI policy. The last IAM policy that we need to attach is Amazon EC2 container registry read only. It allows to download and run Docker images from ECR repository. Now the node group resource. You have a lot of options here to configure your Kubernetes workers. Let's start by associating this instance group with EKS cluster. Give it a name, private nodes, and attach IAM role. Then specify subnets where you want to run your nodes. In this case, we have two private subnets. If you need nodes with public IPs, just replace these IDs with public subnets. For capacity, you can use either on-demand or spot instances that are much cheaper but can be taken away by AWS at any time. Then the instance type. For scaling, this will be important. By itself, EKS cluster will not autoscale your nodes. You need to deploy additional component cluster autoscaler. But to define the minimum and maximum number of nodes, you can use min and max attributes. EKS will use this setting to create AWS autoscaling group on your behalf. Then autoscaler will simply adjust the desired size based on the load. Max unavailable is the desired maximum number of unavailable worker nodes during node group update. You can also create some labels and taints for your nodes. You can use labels to instruct Kubernetes scheduler to use a particular node group by using affinity or node selector. Optionally, you can add taints. They allow a node to repel a set of pods. In case you want to create a custom configuration for your Kubernetes nodes, you can use the launch template. For example, if you need to add additional disks to your workers, we will define this object later. Here is an example to add additional EBS disk of size 50 GB to each node. To manage permissions for your applications that you deploy in Kubernetes, you can either attach policies to Kubernetes nodes directly. In that case, every pod will get the same access to AWS resources. Or you can create OpenID Connect provider, which will allow granting IAM permissions based on the service account used by the pod. First, let's get the certificate for the EKS. Then we can create OpenID provider. I have another video on how to create it using AWS console instead. I highly recommend testing the provider first before deploying the autoscaler. It can save you a lot of time. Let's create a test IAM role. You need to replace the audience with the Kubernetes service account. We will create it in the default namespace and call it AWS test. Now create IAM role. To test provider, let's give it S3 permissions to list buckets. We also need to attach that policy to our test role. For our convenience, we can output to the terminal the IRN of the created role since we would need it in the Kubernetes service account. Alright, let's run the Terraform. Terraform init to download all the plugins, providers, and initialize the state. Then apply to create infrastructure defined in the Terraform code. We have IRN for the test role. To export Kubernetes config, you can use AWS EKS command. Update region and cluster name. A simple test to verify the connection is to run kubectl get services. It will give you the Kubernetes service from the default namespace. Next, to create pod to test IAM roles for service accounts. First, we're going to omit annotations to bind the service account with the role. The way it works, you create a service account and use it in your pod spec. It can be anything, deployment, stateful set, or some job. We're going to use AWS CLI image provided by Amazon. To prevent exiting, let's create infinite loop. Now let's apply it. The pod is running. To test, we can execute arbitrary commands from the pod. In this case, just try to list S3 buckets. We got expected error, access denied. Let me show you the test IAM role that we created with Terraform. In AWS, you can find it in IAM section. We have cluster demo and node group roles. The last one, test OpenID Connect, is the one that we're looking for. We have a test policy with S3 access attached to this role. Also, this is very important. Under trust relationships, you should check the name of the service account and the namespace. Alright, everything looks good. Now we can associate this role with a Kubernetes service account via OpenID Connect provider. It's very easy. You just need to specify the role IRN annotation and provide the IRN itself. You can grab it from the terminal. To avoid any issues, let's just delete everything and recreate it again. Alright, we have a pod back, but already with a service account that has access to S3 buckets. Let's test it now. Run the same command from the pod to list buckets. Now we got a response. We can list buckets, but I don't have any in my project. It's sufficient to check access. Next, let's deploy the sample application and expose it using public and private load balancers. The first is deployment object with a base Nginx image. As an example, I want to show you how to use those labels on node groups using node affinity. Here we require this deployment object to only create pods in node groups with role equal to general. In case you want to use taints, here is another example of how to tolerate them from the deployment. To expose application to the internet, you can create a Kubernetes service of type load balancer and use annotations to configure load balancer properties. By default, Kubernetes will create load balancer in public subnets, so you don't need to provide any additional configurations. Also, if you want a new network load balancer instead of the old classic load balancer, you can add AWS load balancer type equal to NLB. Create both deployment and service objects. We have the Nginx running. Now the service. We have the public LB with external DNS name that can be accessed directly, or you can create a CNAME record. Let's find this load balancer in AWS console. It's going to be under EC2 section. It needs some time to provision. It usually takes a couple of minutes. The scheme is equal to internet facing, which indicates that it is a public load balancer. The type network is coming from the service annotation. Under availability zones, you can verify that those subnets are public. Public US East 1B and public US East 1A. Sometimes, if you have a large infrastructure with many different services, you have a requirement to expose the application only within your VPC. For that, you can create a private load balancer. To make it private, you need additional annotation, AWS load balancer internal, and then provide a CIDR range. Usually, you use 0000/0 to allow any services within your VPC to access it. Let's go back to the terminal and apply it. You can grab the load balancer name and find it in AWS console as well. The difference here, the scheme attribute is internal now. Also, subnets will be private. Don't forget that EKS will use subnet tags to decide where to create public and private load balancers. This one is private US East 1B and private US East 1A. Finally, we got to the EKS Autoscaler. We will be using OpenID Connect provider to create IAM role and bind it with the Autoscaler. Let's create IAM policy and role first. It's similar to the previous one, but Autoscaler will be deployed in the kube system namespace. The name of the service account will be cluster Autoscaler, then the EKS cluster Autoscaler role. We also need to grant access to the Autoscaling group to adjust the desired size. Then attach it to the same EKS cluster Autoscaler role and output the IRN of the role to the terminal. Let's apply the Terraform again to create those objects. That's the role IRN we will use in the Kubernetes service account. Let's start with a service account definition. Then we need to create some RBAC policies for Autoscaler. The important part is that the Autoscaler version has to match with your EKS cluster version. Also, node group AutoDiscovery must be configured properly. Those tags must be present on the Autoscaling group in AWS. The first one is cluster Autoscaler enabled and cluster Autoscaler demo. The demo is EKS cluster name. You have other properties to configure if you want. You can find all the options in documentation. Now let's check if you have proper tags. You can see that all of them are present. Let's deploy Autoscaler. The pod is running in kube system namespace. Always check logs for any errors, especially access issues. It looks like we don't have any errors here. For the last demo, let's split the screen and run kubectl get pods in the top window. And in the bottom, run kubectl get nodes. To test after scaling, just increase the number of pods from 1 to 5. Now we have a few pods in pending state. You can describe one of the pending pods to check if it triggered after scaling. Here is indication that Afterscaler was configured properly. It will scale up the cluster to fit pending pods. Let's wait a little bit to allow the new node to join the cluster. Alright, we have additional Kubernetes node. When it becomes ready, pods will be scheduled. All pods are running now. If you scale down pods back, Afterscaler will remove that node. If you want more videos like this, subscribe to my channel. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.